Hi, welcome to Hanging with Hyde's Daily Devotional. This devotional is dedicated to my two sons, Jerry and Seth. For a hard copy of today's devotional, which includes all scriptural references that support my statements in today's post, please go to my website, HeidiJoLopez.com, and look under the tab, Daily Devotional. Day 57. Good morning. I hope that many, if not all of you, prayed that prayer asking Jesus to fully awaken you. I know I have done it, and at times pray it again. I don't want to miss anything. November was an interesting month. If any of you listened to my video on Hanging with Hyde or read my blog found on my website, HeidiJoLopez.com, you already know what I experienced in November and how I had to deal with it. I mention it now because I want to encourage and strengthen you in leaping into December. I feel that December is a time to sprint toward our mark, not to miss one gift Jesus has left for us, not to miss one opportunity to be a blessing. One thing Satan hates is a unified body of Christ being a blessing wherever we go. We are the light of the world, and we are commanded to be a light for all to see, a city on a hill, not to be hidden. Matthew 5:14. This week in history is very, very crucial. We have the Ghislaine Maxwell case being tried in closed circuit court, which is one of the largest criminal cases in probably our history. Why do I say that? Because this is the tip of the iceberg in exposing all of the vile, horrifically demonic child sacrifice, sex trafficking, and slave trading that has been going on before the end of above ground slavery, and definitely has been ramped up since the abolition of above ground slavery. Why do I say above ground? Because we saw that slavery, and that was vile in and of itself, since the very first person was ever taken into bondage nearly from the beginning of time. Then it was abolished in many powerful nations above ground, meaning what we could see. But it has transferred underground, and under there, it has become far more grotesque and debauched than truly most of us ever want to know. And it has its grotesque demonic tendrils in almost every facet of our society, especially in the elite circles. Also in the courts this week is the tip of the iceberg in overturning legalized abortion. The case Dobbs versus Jackson Women's Health Organization is being heard before the Supreme Court, and they are to decide the fate of this case today. Many of you may feel I am being political, mentioning these two massive cases, but you would be wrong. I am not being political. I am being biblical. Jesus does not turn a blind eye to the sacrifice, abuse, and trafficking of children or adults, and he absolutely abhors abortion. Now, does that mean he hates the one who had an abortion? No. Absolutely not. He loves each and every woman who found herself in that position. He has cried with her. He has longed to heal her heart, make her whole, pull her into his arms, and give her the perfect place of rest. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Romans 8:1. Jesus is reaching out his hand to each and every woman who has had an abortion. No matter how many she has had, he is standing in front of her, just as he did the woman at the well. Whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst, but the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. John 4:14. In that moment, Jesus spoke mysteries to the woman at the well. Then he said to her a simple statement, "Go, call your husband and come here," John 4:16. She answered, "I have no husband," John 4:17. Then Jesus told her he knew she had no husband. He said she had had five husbands, and the man she was living with was not her husband. But something was so different about this man before her. She could see that he was a rabbi, a holy man, yet he spoke with her as if she was on the same level as him. Although religious tradition forbid a rabbi to speak to one such as her, a Samaritan woman, a half-Jew, shunned by all Jews, and not only that, she was shunned by her own people because she had been a woman who had been divorced five times and now was living with a man she was not married to. Yet all Jesus saw was a child he wanted to rescue and bring into his perfect safety and rest. She could see perfect love in him. So when he told her her sins, she didn't feel any condemnation. She felt only perfect love. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. 1 John 4:18. She saw her deliverer, and she took hold of his hand. This is the same perfect love Jesus is extending to every woman who has had an abortion. No condemnation, only perfect love. And there is no fear in trusting him in what he says, because perfect fear, perfect love casts out all fear. We can call sin, sin, but we must always extend love to the people who have been caught in sin's trap. Love that offers freedom, forgiveness, deliverance, care, protection, kindness, restoration, and a release to be the person God always saw that each one of us can be. Just as Abel's blood cried out from the ground to the Lord for justice in Genesis 4:10, all the innocent blood that has been shed since 1973, when abortion became legal in the United States of America, has also been crying out to the Lord for justice. As a matter of fact, every baby who has been aborted since abortion's beginning, no matter the country, has been crying out from the ground to the Lord, capital L-O-R-D, for justice. That is a world-sized harvest of justice. I told you, this is a very historic week. God will bring deliverance and restoration. He is giving man, male and female, an opportunity to stand up and do the right thing, bring justice to the voiceless and the hidden. Yet if man, male and female, does not stand up and declare justice and righteousness, the Lord, capital L-O-R-D, himself will do it. Remember, we are fellow workers with Christ, and every judge has a mantle that is placed on him or her when they are appointed, whether they are aware of it or not. Consider carefully what you do, because you are not judging for man, but for the Lord, who is with you whenever you give a verdict. Now let the fear of the Lord be upon you. Judge carefully, for with the Lord our God, there is no injustice or partiality or bribery. 2 Chronicles 19:6-7. Now, that is very clear. So we must pray for these judges that they will bring God's justice, because if they don't, they will cede for their own destruction. You must serve faithfully and wholeheartedly in the fear of the Lord. In every case that comes before you from your fellow countrymen who lives in the cities, whether bloodshed or other concerns of the law, commands, decrees, or ordinances, you are to warn them not to sin against the Lord. Otherwise, his wrath will come on you and your brothers. Do this and you will not sin. 2 Chronicles 19:9-10. This is all about seed, plant, harvest. The Lord, God in his system of government, is saying that all the laws of the land have been set in motion, spiritual, natural, scientific, and mathematical. All of it is seed, plant, harvest. If you plant seeds of injustice, you will reap a harvest of wrath. As I spoke at length before, we are all first accountable to the Lord for ourselves, whether we are saved or unsaved. And we are also accountable to the Lord for every person under our care, at home, at work, and in our communities. The larger the platform, the greater the harvest, good or bad. Judges are held under the fear of the Lord, which is one of the seven spirits of God who are around the throne of God. Isaiah 11:1-3, Revelation 4:5, Revelation 1:4, Revelation 5:6. These seven spirits rested upon Jesus when he began his ministry. When the Holy Spirit rested upon him as a dove, when Jesus came up out of the water after being baptized by John the Baptist, Luke 3:22. You may be wondering what sparked this drive to share what I shared yesterday and what I am sharing today. Yesterday morning, actually this morning, because I'm doing these both today, in the place of asleep and awake, I heard Holy Spirit say to me, "Iron sharpens iron." I breathed in that word deeply and I awakened a bit more. Then I heard, "Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God." Romans 10:17. Before I fell asleep, I had asked Holy Spirit to give me a word for all of you. I wanted to share what he wanted me to share. So when he spoke those words to me, I knew it was a message he wanted me to say. I picked up my phone and put it in my notes so that the seed of revelation could not be stolen by the enemy of our soul, Satan. I thanked the Lord for the word and trusted him to bring it to fruition. As iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpens the countenance of his friend, Proverbs 27:17. In Hebrew, that word countenance comes from the Hebrew word panim, which translates the face, the part that turns. So in this verse, So a man sharpens the countenance of his friend. It is actually saying a man turns the face of a friend. My sharing these last two devotional days has been about iron sharpening iron, loving you enough to turn your face to the truth. The truth always exposes darkness because truth is light. For everyone practicing evil hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his deeds should be exposed. John 3:20. But the light is truth. How do I know? Then Jesus spoke to them again, saying, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. John 8:12. Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. John 14:6. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. John 8:32. If we see people trying to hide things, or we are trying to hide things, we must ask ourselves the question, what are they afraid of? Or what am I afraid of? Jesus is perfect love. Perfect love casts out fear, and the truth shall make us free. Simply, all we have to do is call out to Jesus to save us. His perfect love will cast out fear, which is a spirit, and he, truth himself, will make us free. We do not need to fear sickness, even in plague form, real or imagined. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day, nor of the pestilence that walks in darkness. Psalm 91:5-6. We don't need to fear what man can do to us. The Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can man do to me? Psalm 118:6. We don't need to fear anything. Yet in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Romans 8:37. See, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. 1 John 4:18. And who is love? God is love. And he who abides, rests, and lives in love, abides, rests, and lives in God, and God in him. 1 John 4:16. I speak blessing of truth, love, and the light of Jesus Christ to fill you, bring you to perfect freedom in Jesus, to know your destiny, and to choose to set your course to fulfill it. Be awake, be aware, and be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. 1 Peter 5:8. Now may the God of peace, who brought up our Lord Jesus from the dead, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you complete in every good work to do his will, working in you what is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Hebrews 13:20-21.